Welcome to Tech Trends. Tech Trends is a podcast series that provides perspective on the latest trends in technology, fintech, and digital. On today's episode, we'll provide some insight into the online platform economy and how it's changed the business and labor landscape over the last number of years, and how companies and employees can take advantage of its fast-paced developments to ensure success. I'm Anish Bhimani, Chief Information Officer for Commercial Banking, and joining me today is Fiona Greig, Co-President of the JPMorgan Chase Institute. Fiona, welcome to Tech Trends.
Thank you. Thanks for having me.
So a lot of our listeners may not be familiar with the JPMorgan Chase Institute, or that the firm even has its own internal think tank. Can you talk a little bit about the mission of the organization and your role with it?
We are a think tank inside JPMorgan Chase. And as the co-president, I lead a team of economists and data scientists who are mining the daily transaction data of all of the activities that flow through the bank in a de-identified and anonymized way. The work that we do is intended for the public good. Everything goes on a public website with the goal of informing policymakers, business leaders, CFOs of businesses like your, like this audience, on exactly what's going on in the economy, with the intent that, you know, given that the firm has a relationship with roughly half the households in the US, this can be a window onto the world, onto the U.S. economy, that's pretty broadly representative of that economy, not just the Chase portfolio.
So you're able to basically take all of that aggregated, anonymized data and identify trends and what's going on, whether it be in the economy or certain other trends going on.
Yeah, exactly. I mean, the goal is not really, it is to use the vantage point that is offered by these data. And if you think about the biggest, at the highest level, you know, Chase has a relationship with roughly half the households in the US. Mm-hmm. And so this is an incredibly large data set from which we try to then build an understanding of what's going on in the economy as representative of the economy at large.
So it's clear that the online platform economy has had a big impact on the way business is conducted and labor is defined, both in the U.S. and across the globe. Can you dig a little deeper into some of your findings and how you see the online platform economy affecting the global economy going forward?
Yes, and the language, as you point out, is a tricky one. There are many words for this phenomenon, and I think our intent with the term online platform economy was actually to carve out the small piece of this that we observe with the bank data. So if you think, you know, the original economy on this earth, right, would have looked a lot like gig work, right? People mm-hmm. being paid in a casual way for services that they were being offered. And so too, that casual work still exists, be they, you know, caretakers, painters, any number of people who are working in, you know, for themselves and perhaps not through the form of sort of W-2 standard contract labor. When we first started thinking about this project, we said, well, what is our viewpoint into this? And our viewpoint was limited, but very powerful. And that is to say, with the rise of, you know, online platforms, the first of which would probably be something like eBay, right? It was a selling platform where sellers could be connected in a sort of peer-to-peer way with buyers, right? You didn't have to be a big store like Amazon or a big store like Nike. You could just be somebody selling stuff out of your garage. And that's probably the origin story of the online platform economy. Over time, if that was where it got its beginning, it quickly, with really the entrance of the transportation platforms, shifted from a marketplace of goods to a marketplace of services. And so over, you know, the last 10 years is when we really started to see this rise. You know, we see an enormous increase in people supplying their time on these transportation services. And I'll talk about actually four different segments that we are now tracking. So if the original one were selling platforms, we identified three others that are pretty important now. So one is transportation. The other would be all the other non-transport work where people are selling their time. This could be things like dog walking, cutting people's hair, you know, legal services, any kind of service that is not transportation. And then the fourth one is the leasing sector. And that is would be, you know, things like Airbnb and the like, where you're leasing assets of kind, whether it's real estate or vehicles and things like that. And clearly since 2012, I mean, the big growth has been transportation. But there's also been significant growth in some of these others that are just still in their earlier stages, right? Whether it's the leasing platforms or other non-transport work. I mean, after kind of Uber and Lyft entered, you would hear in the tech circles, well, I'm the Uber for dog walking, or I'm the Uber for, you know, everybody, every new entrant was, I'm the Uber of X. And as we tracked these platforms, we started with a list of 30, then we moved to a list of 42, and then we were up to 128 or some platforms, even by, you know, in 2018. And actually the sector that had seen the largest growth in the number of platforms was this non-transport work category, right? Where people were trying to emulate what Uber and Lyft had done with another kind of service. So a couple of things I just call out about this space in general, and maybe some of the specific subsectors. So as of, you know, the end of 2018, at any given month, we observed about 1.5% of the population earning income from one of these platforms. And I should be clear that we were really studying the supply side of this, right? People earning income from this, not so much the purchase or the demand side where people are buying goods and services. Obviously, much larger share than 1% of the population was buying goods or services off of these platforms. So 1.5% in any given month. However, if we looked over the prior year, it was more like 4.5%, meaning that lots of people were doing this on a very sporadic basis. They would, you know, the vast majority would earn income off of these platforms in a couple of months out of the year, not really the whole year. In the month in which they were participating, this is a meaningful source of income for them. Roughly, maybe as much as half of their income was coming from these platforms. But over the course of the year, it was actually a small piece of their income. And so you can kind of get a sense of the ways in which people were churning in and out of these platforms in order to supplement their income, right? They were not necessarily treating this like a full-time job. They were treating this as a side gig, right? To the term. Right. And so I think that's important, because with the emergence of this space came so many policy questions. What does this mean for the future of work? How should we be classifying these participants? Are they being underpaid in the form of all of the non-wage benefits that right. normally come with a job, like healthcare, like right. unemployment benefits, like, you know, disability insurance, any number of other benefits? And on the one hand, with the growth, I think these are really important questions, and we're seeing the growth of the contract workspace as a whole, the larger gig economy that you started with, of which the platform economy is just a small piece. There's been work suggesting that has really been growing, and we've seen a sort of a fissuring in the workplace, and that those larger questions of, you know, what should the social contract be of the future if the typical job that someone has is no longer a W-2 job that comes right. with all of these benefits. So I think those questions are all still real. And at the time that we were studying this, the suppliers themselves weren't actually treating this like a full-time job. So I think therein came the idea of things like portable benefit structures. You know, can I accrue across a number of different employers or workplaces, points towards, or can I cobble together some package of benefits across these different places that I'm earning income, be it a formal job or be it a platform job or otherwise. So there remain many open policy questions about how these workers should be designated, what kinds of benefits should they be able to have access to, many of which have been, reopened even during COVID. And I know we'll talk about that a little bit later.
Yeah, it is interesting. You've seen that come up in a lot of places on, should these individuals be considered employees, let's say, of the rideshare platforms, or are they independent contractors? And what are the implications on companies for that as well? Is there anything that companies that employ folks from this economy should think about, be aware of as they do that?
Yeah. So as an economist, one of the, you know, part of the elegance of these marketplaces is that you could have the supply curves shift in and out and the demand curves shift in and out and the pricing automatically adjusts, right? And, you know, that's sort of the perfect marketplace, right? And so on the other hand, I think there are really important questions around, you know, minimum wages, for example. There is nothing in some of these platforms, pricing algorithms, that prevents the price or the wage from falling to zero, yeah. Right? There's nothing in the algorithm that enforces a lower bound. And I say that because, you know, we did see over time that revenues, specifically revenues, not necessarily wages, because we couldn't discern how many hours people were working, but revenues on these transportation platforms had fallen considerably over the time that we had, the number of months and years that we were studying this. And that kind of makes sense. You know, I think some of these transportation platforms, you know, drove really hard in a particular place to attract workers to the platform, to stand it up so that the first time, you know, you're in the city of Cincinnati and you open up one of these apps and you try and call somebody, that a driver actually shows up in a decent amount of time, right? However, the apps continue to innovate, right? So for example, one of the features that came up was that drivers could choose their destination, and they could try to pick up a passenger. They could mm-hmm. specify that they wanted to pick up a passenger on their way home or on their way to work. And in economic terms, what that does is it lowers the opportunity cost of that driver's time right then and there, right? Because this is their commute anyway, right? And so in some sense, it lowers the price that they're willing to be paid for their time. And so I think in a world where, you know, we do care about inequality in this world, I think thinking about those lower bounds, that minimum wage framework in the context of even these marketplaces is pretty important.
So it's clear that the online platform economy has had a huge impact on the way business is conducted, the way people think about labor, both in the US and around the world. Can you dig a little bit deeper into some of your findings and how you see the online platform economy impacting the global economy moving forward?
You know, the online platform economy is interesting insofar as it opens up, in the way that we've been seeing it trended anyway, an entire world of supply of services, right? Especially insofar as some of these services aren't in person, right? They're not driving from A to B. They are legal services. They are coding services. They are, you know, market or graphic design services, whatever they may be, especially in these non-transport work platforms. And if you pair that concept where you've got a marketplace where you can find a lawyer anywhere who's willing to work on an hourly basis on any matter, with the work from home acceptance and every way in which our workplace has been transformed through COVID, you can see how we might see more and more fissuring of the workplace, right? It might be more and more acceptable for a firm, or reasonable for a firm, to contract out their legal services, as opposed to feeling like this is a job that that needs to sit in a cubicle in an office, right? And so I think the emergence of these platforms, which creates that marketplace where it's easy to find people, it's easy for people to find business, you know, suppliers and buyers can be paired in this peer-to-peer way and paid through those platforms, you know, paired with COVID and the work from home virtual workplace, kind of positions this space for growth, I think is fair to say.
It really does, you know, not just lower, but almost decimate the barrier to entry, you know, on the supply side, at least, right? So the same way you mentioned when eBay first came out, you didn't have a big retail store, you could find a way to sort of sell your goods. And now it's the, hey, you know, I have some free time, I can sign up with a Handy or a TaskRabbit or somebody and offer out my services individually. you know, it does open that up dramatically, and you don't have to be necessarily be in all the big cities. You can do whatever you, you know, need to do from a lot of different places too, right?
Yeah, the only thing I would say is that I think that's true when it comes to, you know, handy and yep. services per se. I think when it comes to selling goods,
yep.
it's really hard to compete on the World
yeah.
Wide Web
right.
as a small person or a small right. shingle.
Right. But now let's talk about how a growing economy, like you said, there's lots of opportunity for growth. A growing online platform economy creates space for either new companies to form or current businesses to pivot in order to take advantage of this space, right? So a lot of our viewers are business owners or entrepreneurs themselves. What sort of opportunities do you see for them ahead? And how might business leaders capitalize on these trends in terms of how commerce is conducted and labor is deployed?
Well, you know, because my team and I look at banking data all the time, one of the rather maybe dorky but fascinating for me aspects of this work is that we get really interested in the channels by which people transact, right? And they matter to us because if you swipe a debit card, I know generally what kind of merchant one was at and whether that was a, you know, grocery store or, you know, something else. But if you pay by cash, I have no idea what this was spent on and I can't make sense of that transaction. And obviously with COVID, we've seen just a huge increase in electronic purchases, you know, movement away from cash, check, and whether that's for the purposes of paying rent or paying medical bills or buying stuff or paying people for any kind of service, moving on to these electronic payment platforms, I think is just a thing that, you know, businesses should be, you know, adopting and enabling that. And that is the way of the future for sure. But it is also the one of the important premises of the platform economy itself, right? One of the huge innovations, it didn't seem like rocket science, but of course, as a consumer, this is one of the ways in which, you know, these transportation platforms create value, right? Consumer surplus is that you no longer had to stop and pause at your destination to rifle through your wallet for either the right amount of cash or a credit card and swipe and, you know, and it never went through. You just exited, right? You just left the vehicle and off you went. And so I wouldn't underestimate the power of payment channels and those electronic payment channels as being a means, a superhighway to additional ways to serve people in more convenient mm-hmm. ways. So that's one. I would say, secondly, as an example of that, we've seen huge growth in online purchases generally, as opposed to brick and mortar purchases. So when we track, you know, commerce growth across cities, you see this both in our administrative data from the Institute, but also in things like federal surveys, like the monthly retail trade survey, you know, 30%+ growth in year over year growth in online spend. And so that just, I think, raises questions for lots of businesses, you know, wow, how can we deliver the same goods and services online? I'm sure every business has been wrestling with that question during COVID. But not only is that interesting as perhaps a business challenge, but also not a business opportunity, right? Because the minute you're online, you're no longer restricted to the dotted line circle around your geographic storefront. You could be selling to the entire globe. So that's kind of another thing.
So we've talked about COVID. Obviously, it's hard to think about this without thinking about the impact the pandemic has had, you know, on the gig economy and around that too. Can you talk about sort of, you know, how that has either changed or accelerated the online platform economy?
Yeah, so I should be clear at the outset that, you know, our data go through the end of 2018. So I don't have actually platform economy data to speak of that's from 2020 or current. Mm-hmm. However, I think a couple of things. One is, if I were to, you know, interpolate the lines forward through COVID of the four different sectors I mentioned, you know, I think transportation probably took a downtick, you know, with offsetting subcomponents of that where, you know, nobody's driving people from point A to point B anymore. However, those same drivers might be driving stuff around town, right? They might be driving food deliveries and lots of it. So do I think the food deliveries offset all of the people moving? Probably not. And that's why I think probably those transportation that platforms probably took a dive, but I can't confirm. You know, the goods merchants, the selling merchants, for sure, you know, a big uptick. I think, you know, the leasing, you know, the Airbnbs and the like, probably a big downtick. I mean, yes, we had people needing long-term rentals to get out of town and have a change of pace. I know in my family, we offloaded for an Airbnb for 4 weeks, but, you know, we're not seeing the onesies and twosies, the weekend getaways and all that sort of thing in COVID, just because of the, you know, huge drag on travel in general. And the vast majority of us are stuck at home more than we would prefer to be.
It's also interesting is about, like, if I look at our neighborhood, you know, we were joking the other day that we used to see black cars, you know, everywhere driving people around. They've all been replaced now with delivery drivers, right? So there's no shortage of people in the environment. It's just a different nature of what they're doing. But I also have to think that a lot of those consumption patterns that we've seen in COVID, whether it be buying more goods online, employing more services, whatever, you know, might be here to stay, right? So could you talk a little bit about how, you know, looking forward, let's say in a post-pandemic environment, you know, how the labor market, how the economy might be changing, and how the online platform economy can complement the traditional labor market of tomorrow?
Yeah, that's a big question. Yeah. I think so. Let me take some pieces of it in turn. During COVID, we've seen tremendous growth in purchases of goods. And a big downtick in purchases of services. So how much of that is going to continue? I think that balance of goods versus services probably won't continue, right? There's only one refrigerator that you can replace. Right. That, you know, and people have a huge pent-up demand for all of the services they used to enjoy, rather, be it, you know, leisure, restaurant, mm-hmm. travel, all sorts of things like that. So I think some of that balance will revert back to what we're used to seeing in the past. On the other hand, what I think is here to stay is the shift to online, right? We've all, if we hadn't already learned how to be a consumer online, we have now. And whether that's buying groceries online, buying, you know, clothing online, you name it, people have learned how to do that, seen that it can work, done it for months and months and months, you know, consumed a year's worth of a family life online. And I think that's here to stay. You know, I think other things that are here to stay are, you know, I think many firms are reevaluating their appetite for, you know, work from home, and that has downstream impacts on all kinds of services, right? Whether it's, you know, quotidian things like, you know, dry cleaning, mm-hmm. or whether it's the types and businesses and the number of them and their vibrancy of businesses that rely on those business commuters. You know, an example of that, not just working in person, but, you know, the business related travel, which I don't think will ever come back, or at least not for a while, to the volumes that we had prior to COVID, you know? Mm-hmm. So I think there are some things that are going to change in more durable ways, specifically in the services sector. But, you know, and the ways in which people are transacting, move to online, move to, you know, electronic payment channels, I think that's here to stay. And those are examples of, you know, I've heard folks say, you know, we've experienced 10 years of innovation in 10 months. Right. And those are examples of it. I don't know if you've experienced this, but I've certainly consumed healthcare remotely and virtually. And, you know, that first week when mom and dad were both on calls and baby falls down the stairs, the first thing we did was have a virtual visit with our pediatrician. And it was phenomenal, right? It allayed all my worries that my child had a concussion. That's amazing. I think that sort of thing should stay. So anyway, there will be winners and losers in terms of what stays and what returns.
So finally, just for our viewers out there, I think the message is that no matter what, the shift to online, the shift to digital is really an imperative. If it wasn't before, I think this just sort of, you know, really underscored it for everybody how important that's going to be. But equally, you know, if you think about all of the back end logistics and fulfillment processes and all that kind of stuff that became a big part of how everybody sort of dealt with daily business, should probably get relooked at as well, right? Are there things where you can involve, you know, more individuals from the economy to do fulfillment on those other sort of things? How can you, you know, compete with a lot of these, these platforms that are offering those same sort of services, right?
That's right.
So Fiona, we've talked a lot about COVID, and it's hard not to think about the impact that the pandemic has had, not just on the online platform economy, but the economy more broadly. Can you talk about sort of, you know, what COVID has meant to the online platform economy?
Yeah, so obviously through COVID, we've seen dramatic job losses, and those job losses have been disproportionately felt by low-income families, by women and women of color. And that's a backdrop, right? That means that there's a huge amount of labor supply out there, people who need income. Many of these people, you know, would have received the stimulus payment of April of 2020, as well as unemployment insurance benefits, but many people may not have, or may have had to wait several weeks for those benefits to arrive, and may have turned to the platform economy for work or for a source of income. So certainly, not only has there been an increase in demand because people have moved to these online and electronic payment platforms, but there's likely an increase in supply of the labor that is on these, you know, people who are seeking income through any number of ways. And, you know, there were hiring freezes in many sectors, and this kind of gig or short-term employment might have been a way in which people might have been able to find flexible work or short-term work to bridge the gap between, you know, their employment from the past or the job that they lost, and either a recall back to that job or the unemployment benefits that they might have been waiting for. I think within that, though, you know, one of the things we saw from our work, you know, prior to COVID was that actually there was a reasonable gender difference in the extent to which people were participating on these platforms. So in the transportation sector, and specifically which has contributed most of the growth to the platform economy, there was a big gender gap. Men were more likely to be participating in these platforms. They were more likely to turn to these platforms when they were between jobs. And so that raises a question for me, because if this seems like an income generating strategy, but more so for men than for women, but it was actually the women who lost the jobs, mm-hmm. Would they turn to the platform economy? And if so, to what kinds of platforms? If not transportation, maybe they were exploring some of these other services, non-transportated related services, or, you know, leasing services. Where we did see more gender balance in those non-transport work platforms, leasing platforms, selling platforms. I mean, Etsy is an example of a platform that is disproportionately women. So, you know, to what kinds of sectors did they flock? That there may have been a big gender difference, and certainly there was a gender, you know, differences in how the economy was hit. So those would be a few things that I would underscore.
Well, I think it's clear that between the, as you point out, the job losses causing an increase in supply, and also the increasing shift to online purchasing or consumption of services, whatever, that some of what we see in COVID might be here to stay going forward, right? Can you talk a little bit about how the online platform economy might complement, let alone subsume, some of the more traditional labor market, and especially when we think about the increased acceptance of remote work, work from home, other things like that? You know, what does that mean for this going forward?
If firms start to think outside the box and realize that, you know, certain occupations within their firm or business doesn't need to be on premise, they've just learned over the last, you know, 10 months that this job can be performed perfectly well from home remotely, then that does kind of call into question as to whether this needs to be a full-time worker. Mm-hmm. Does this need to be a W-2 worker? Or can this rather be a contract that I have on a permanent, you know, on a temporary basis as needed when I need this service or this role? And so, you know, I worry because some of those, that does create potential growth for these platforms and maybe cost savings for firms. At the same time, you know, back to the policy questions and sort of the social contract, if more workers end up in these kinds of contract gig economy arrangements, you know, they're likely to experience fewer benefits from the, you know, lower retirement savings, lower, health insurance benefits and things like that. Now, some of those have come into question. You know, the CARES Act provided a lot of relief for families during COVID. And one of the really important things it did was it actually expanded unemployment insurance benefits, not just in terms of the level, right? A lot of people have heard about the extra $600, mm-hmm. you know, and then which has been renewed to the tune of $300 per week, but it also expanded the eligibility. And for the first time, contingent gig workers were now eligible to receive unemployment insurance benefits, which hadn't previously been the case. And so, at the same time that, you know, there's all this discussion about whether we need to re-up CARES and which parts of the benefits and relief need to be extended or continued while we're still in the pandemic, I think it's opening up a broader long-term, you know, set of research or policy questions around, you know, should there be more broad-based unemployment insurance reform? I know I'm getting a little bit beyond the question of tech, but when we talk about the future of work, you know, these end up being important externalities associated with those transformations, right? And if one, you know, right now we have not just one unemployment insurance system, we have 53. It's each and every state has their own system. And the federal government playing a role in indicating that gig workers ought to be eligible for unemployment insurance during a pandemic raises a question as to whether they should be eligible in business cycles more broadly, or even on a go forward basis when people experience job loss on their own.
Yeah, you see those. You know, I've seen the signs in New York for the insurance for freelancers and things like that for years, right? I think it is just making that more and more mainstream and affecting a much broader part of the population, right?
Yeah.
Well, Fiona, thanks so much for joining us today, providing your insights on such an important topic that's so relevant with what's going on right now. I can't wait to see what the future holds.
Thanks for having me.
And to all of our listeners, thanks very much for joining us today. Remember, if you enjoyed this episode, you can subscribe and rate us on Apple Podcasts, Spotify, or wherever you get your podcasts. Tune in next time.